Okay.
So he's gonna tell us about accelerating free energy evaluation with Tinker HP.
Yeah, thank you.
So we'll start to thank the organizer for inviting me. So today, I will try to show you some new results using polarizable force fields. And I will show you some ideas related to the developments we are doing to speed up, in fact, these models. So these models, you know them, they are the polarizable force fields. So in the community, they can be seen as slow. They are, I think, more used in chemistry these days, like, but not yet widely in free energy evaluation. So, but my strong belief is that they should be more used, and I would try to convince you that it's maybe time to look at it a little bit more. So the main advantage they should bring you is to bring you more physics, because like by design, they have features such as separability, and because they don't have the functional form of the classical force field, and each of the components are basically based on physics, and they will reproduce different physical effects like electrostatic, induction, dispersion, or things like that. Also, since they are related a bit more related to quantum mechanics, they should include anisotropy, which can be really important in docking. And they will have the mini body effects, and the mini body effects is really what is causing trouble for free energy, because mini body effects are not always going in the same direction. You can have cooperative effects, and it will be the case in hydrogen bonded complexes. But if you are dealing with metalloproteins, your many body effects could be anti-cooperative, and you will have an opposed physics to the cooperativity. So of course, if you are dealing with these problems in your metalloprotein and you want to do free energy, you will be in trouble because pairwise force field will have difficulties there. So because all of that, these force fields are expected to be more transferable. So as they are grounded on quantum mechanics, their aim is really to get access to small energetical differences. So even if they are slower, they should help you to get results where classical force fields have problems. So they are pretty good for everything related to metals. And they provide also things beyond free energies, and it can be interesting in pharma if you are interested by breaking bonds, and chemistry break bonds. So liquid phase hybrid KMMM is something that is starting to work. And that's what your software is also doing. So all these force fields they have in common to be built on tools and objects which are a little bit more complex than point charges. So they need distributed multipoles, they need polarizabilities, and they also need quantum chemistry in a different way. All these models are relying on energy decomposition analysis, so there are various schemes. But you need all of that to build these models, but it's not a main issue, and these things are starting to be well understood. The problem was the scalability of this model. Okay, so the difference between a force field which is widely used by a community and just another interaction potential model is really small, and if you don't scale, basically nobody will use your model. And so we needed something like a full framework, like NAMD or GROMAX, to really speed up these slow polarizable models. So as a proof of concept, and since we are working on the Tinker software, which was the place the Amoeba force field was born, we tried to speed up this kind of technology using the Amoeba force field. for many reasons. One reason is theoretical. It's like it's not the most complex force field, but it has the key features that we are interested with. So he has distributed multipoles, he has polarization, and he has all the framework to do periodic boundary conditions, polarizable, and it is fitted on partially on ab initio. So amoeba is really the, I would say, like a very good test to demonstrate that these generations of models are scalable. So also, one other thing is that in its back to yesterday talk from the Ponders group, amoeba is really working for free energy, okay? So not only for relative free energy. So yesterday you saw a result on absolute free energy using this amoeba polarizable force fields on this really difficult compounds. And it actually works, okay? It really works. You can really nail very difficult problem. And this parametrization is really something which is starting to be automatized. So in practice, everything is ready for the simulation to be tested by people, okay? So what is the key issue is the speed, okay? So all my talk will be about to show you that the speed is now present and that you can start to try these models. So in order to accelerate amoeba, we needed to change, in fact, the platform itself. So the platform is Tinker. So probably some of you have been using it over the years. So Tinker is still existing, so the canonical Tinker. But we added two other codes, Tinker OpenMM and Tinker HP, okay? So these two codes are two different strategies to speed up the process, one using GPU and the other one using CPU in a MPI framework. So the first is Tinker OpenMM. So that's what has been used in the previous result I just showed you from amoeba. So the really key thing is like this platform is providing everything you need to do absolute and relative alchemical free energies. So I won't go through all the details of the method which are in the package, but they are available and they can work really fast, in fact, thanks to the OpenMM plugin. And you can use everything that is available in Tinker on these GPU cards. So in a nutshell, if you use a GTX 1090, it's already a 200-fold acceleration other a single CPU, okay? But if you are using the latest cards, it can be up to 400. The interesting thing, and that will be a big point of my talk, is that it works for free energy because we are doing short simulations, okay? So one key thing, people should be a little bit cautious when they are using GPUs and polarizable force field, is that if you do the same computation in CPU and in GPU, it looks okay, and it's pretty okay, so for Tinker OpenMM, to a certain point. So for small trajectories, it's okay, but you see small differences, okay, in free energy, and that is linked, in fact, to the resolution of the polarization equations, okay? So usually these points are not really discussed, but you can trace it back to the mixed precision. And that's because, in fact, you are inverting matrices, and these matrices, they have properties, okay? And so one key aspect of this simulation is you want to keep the form of these matrices to be able to do your simulation. So if you want to use the free energy Tinker OpenMM, you don't have much problem. If you are doing FEP type calculation, it works very well, and it is pretty fast. So 200-fold, Jay showed us yesterday that it was really starting to be enough to make a lot of nice things. But we have been trying, in fact, to push this acceleration really further because we would like also to probably tackle free energies on really large systems. And GPUs are great, but they have limited capabilities. And so the idea was to design an extended version of Tinker called Tinker HP that will scale, in fact, on a lot more computational resources. So we designed the code also to be used in lab clusters. Okay, so if you don't have a supercomputer and you have local resources, the code will adapt to what it has. And the idea is to really scale, to make this polarizable force field scale. So how does it work, and what has been changed compared to the previous type of approaches? So the first thing, and that's a little bit technical, but that's really to put you in perspective what are the issues in this new generation force field. So now you have a lot of new things in these methods, like a lot of matrix vector product, which are really time consuming and which are also really sensitive to precision. Okay, so when you are dealing with that, in fact, you are getting closer to quantum mechanics. So you cannot have exactly the same, follow the same rules that for classical force fields and the way to implement them. So we needed, in fact, to fix several things, like the way to compute this matrix vector. So we are using PME, like to speed up the process. But what you need to do is to have access to massive parallelism. So in a way, you have this big matrix, you compute the polarization energy here, and you have this gigantic matrix to invert, okay? So polarizable force field can be seen as a gigantic matrix inverser. And so that's changing quite a lot, in fact, all the algorithmic you have to deal with. So the key thing also is, like, of course you can do the nice math, use conjugate gradient, but we had to really come out with something different from the conjugate gradient, because there is a technical issue, in fact, that if you don't converge completely your conjugate gradient, the equations that are producing the energy and the derivatives, they assume, in fact, that you have a fully converged energy to compute the derivative. In practice, nobody is doing that because it's making iterations, and too many iterations is killing your scaling. So they compute the derivative a little bit before the convergence, and that will give you drifts, okay? So these drifts, in fact, you don't want them, but also you don't want this iterative schemes with lots of iteration, because it's really new for biophysics, okay? So we resort now to something which is really important, I think, is non-iterative scheme called the truncated conjugate gradient. So this new generation of force field, they can include polarization without iterations, okay? So that's really, really, really important, because you don't have this cyclic self-consistent calculation. And now you have analytical derivatives, okay? Your gradients are exact. And so that means that you will have no more this drift issue, and you can really go to long time scale, okay? So by doing that, you remove some of the aspects you are finding in molecular dynamics, like using predictor correctors, etc., because we don't need that. We don't have time history, and we have all the features we want. We are fully time reversible, and we don't resort on any thermostats or any tricks that would perturb, in fact, the application of statistical mechanics after. Okay. So the key thing is, if you look at what these solvers are doing, that's the blue line. It's perfectly conserving energy, okay? Before, depending on your convergence, you had this, I would say, these fluctuations. And these fluctuations put, I would say, that with some numerical instabilities, are really a risk, in fact, for your free energy simulation. With this type of solver, it's completely gone. And that's the heart, in fact, of TinkerHP. It has also other advantages. It's like you can couple it to multi-time step, okay? Because since the cost of this solver is not depending on the number of iterations, it's always the same cost. So there are new families of integrators that can be, you can really now push the time step without having resonance effects. So you can have for the same price as a one femtosecond, 3, 5, and even 7 femtoseconds with this new generation. And TCG will have the same cost. That means that it's really reducing like a lot the cost of your polarizable simulation. So, and the good thing is since you have a very limited number of vector matrix products, you have less problem with GPU stability. So this thing will really be applicable to GPUs, because in fact GPU is really well known in math. You don't they don't like conjugate gradient. If you do conjugate gradient with a lot of iterations, it will fail. So basically, all this technology will also work to be speed up by GPU accelerators. So what we did after is to plug it into the 3D domain decomposition. So we used DeShow's neutral territories. So that's really interesting because it helps you to really localize your data into a machine. So you can really nail all the communication, deal with the dynamical memory allocation. And if you couple that to massively parallel list builder, you can really have something using polarization, which scale like NAMD or Gromax. So of course, the amount of work that should be done in 3D domain decomposition because of polarization is a lot larger, okay? So you have a lot more FFTs. So that explains the difference of cost between a classical force field and amoeba. In our framework is approximately 5, okay? So the cost of using polarization is 5 times your classical computation. So what does it do? And that was, in fact, the numbers from the paper. So the good thing, it scales very well, okay? One of the really of the asset of the code is this really high scalability. More you add cores, better it works. And you can really get on the DHFR, which is the usual molecule everybody is testing for everything, like from the join Charm Ember benchmark. You can get around 7-8 nanoseconds per day, which if you compare to GPUs, is almost the same thing on the GTX 1080, okay? If you take the really latest Volta, it would be more because the Volta is really great. You can go up to 60. But what I mean here is like it's not ridiculous. And if you look at what the CPU were doing before, it's a lot better. And in fact, doing polarizable dynamics on CPU is a little bit. The gap is smaller than for classical molecular dynamics. So compared to Tinker, it's more than a 200 acceleration. But this system, in fact, is really small, in fact. It's really small for molecular dynamics. And so things are changing if you grow the size of the system. And then the curves are crossing, and the CPUs are coming back to win. So 200 atoms, it's already the case. So the CPUs are getting faster. Getting close to 1 million atoms is even more striking. And the accelerations are increasing, like 700 times compared to Tinker, more than 1,000 around 1 million atoms. So the big thing is there is no memory limitation. And we can play with a lot of things with double precision. So double precision is a burden. But also, it gives you some assets. It's like in the quantum code. Some of the things, some algorithmics can be used only in double precision. So really, the point of that is to also try to dock, for example, drugs in big things like that, like ribosome, or to simulate processes of in viruses to look at RNA. So actually, that's we are doing AV simulation on the tobacco virus. So, and here you really see the benefit of that. It's a nearly 5,000 time acceleration. And even there, you cannot do it that on Tinker because there is not enough memory, okay? So you can have really meaningful parallelizable simulation now, and the speed is large enough to do free energy simulation, okay? So these were the results from last year, and we pushed that like a joke, in fact, to see where we can go. So basically, give me a computer and we can make big system, but at some point, there is no point. We did 2.7 picosecond, but okay. So what we are doing now is what I showed you were on the old processors, okay? So everything is evolving and CPUs are evolving too, okay? So you have speedups on the new GPUs, but you have also new CPUs, and now the CPUs are coming with new sets of instruction, AVX512, that allows you to do vectorization. And vectorization is really something new that people should consider because it is a huge speed up. So these are the numbers of last month, so the code was not fully vectorized, but it already jumped from 6 to 14, okay? So it's starting to really catch up the best Tesla card. And I think we'll be able to do better at the end of the year. There are several things. So 16 nanoseconds per day is really enough to make compounds in the same day. So what's next? And that's the perspective. So things are really not finished. We are in the process, in fact, to complexify the resolution of the polarization evaluation, because you don't have to resolve all your system at the same level. So if you are doing really big system, you can coarse grain polarization and keep the full polarization in the region of interest for your free energy calculation. I already spoke of that, but we have these improved integrators. So they are really important because I think in the future it will really impact the field. And also, at this point, we haven't messed at any moment with statistical mechanics. Everything we have done is just algorithmic to reformulate molecular dynamics. So you can speed up now sampling with method like OSRW. And OSRW, on top of that, is a factor 10, okay, on free energy. So if you put all together, all these things, you can do a lot of compounds in a day, okay? So before coming to the conclusion, so what are the next steps? So the platform TinkerHP has been designed as a reference code. It is double precision. And we try not to cut any corner to have a reference values for simulation forces. But now we can degrade, in fact, the algorithmic to try to play with precisions. And that's what we will do to mix, in fact, GPUs and CPUs. There are new platforms now which are quite interesting and that should really speed up more the polarizable force fields. And especially knowing that something is coming and coming big in US, it will be in 2021. And this big machine, you will need to have an exascale ready code, okay? And they will give you 1,000 times faster, not faster, but 1,000 times more resources than you have now. So everything I've done is on machines like, which are like 25 petaflop, but from 25 to 1,000, that's a lot, okay? So that means that if some of you have access to these things, that would be a lot of compounds. So conclusion, so basically, the two branches of Tinker have achieved a huge speed up. So Tinker OpenMM is working really well and it's taking benefit of the new generation cards. So each card is getting better. So just change the card, recompile, and you will get really good results. Tinker HP is able to scale more and it will continue to be improved thanks also to mix with GPUs. And the applicability, I think, of free energy computations is completely extended now with parasitable force fields. And you don't have very strong limitations. So of course, if you want to do a million compounds, it's not possible, but I think it's not the point. Probably the idea of that is to look at some difficult compound with this technology. And I'm pretty sure it will give good answers. So also, there is a new release of Tinker HP. And we know how the classical force field like Amber Charm or PLS. So for some people who are really willing to compare polarizable and non-polarizable, the software will offer this possibility. And the last point is that Amoeba is only the first of the polarizable force field coming in Tinker. There will be others. So this year, we are putting the SIFA model, which is one of the first ab initio force field. And we will have the successor of Amoeba later in the year. So and you will see that they don't cost really a lot more. It's not it's pretty close to the scalings I've shown you, but it's even more accurate. Okay, so I think that's the right moment to start to look at these methodologies because some of them may be useful. So I will just finish by thanking my collaborators, especially Pengyu Ryan and Jay Ponder, and will thank you for your attention. It depends. Like, for Amoeba, it can be quick. Like, if you have everything with you, like the Psi-4 and you have two frameworks. Now you have the pole type, like the one which is given. It will be a few hours. But Jay Ponder is working on an automatized process, so which is coming, and it will really, really reduce the time. So most of it is getting in an automatic processing now. So the only thing that can happen sometimes is having problem with the quantum mechanics because you need multiples. It will slow you down from time to time, but not too much. Like it's getting mature. So
roughly, like a few years ago, was about a week.
Yeah, it's less, and it will be less and less because the like more people are using it, and so we are refining the codes, and some people are specifically working on this piece of code. So it's not a bottleneck.
So in the context of the non-polarizable force fields in Tinker HP or whatever it's called, you know, classically the issue is always the FFTs are the thing that break down the scalability. Are you doing anything there, or do you see this fall over for the classical force field? And you're just not seeing it because the work, the communication ratio is much, much larger.
We have a lot more communications, but we are killed at the end by FFTs.
Right.
So, but it happens that it starts to be an issue at 3 million atoms. So we have a fast multipole code, which is in progress. But the problem is it's already a lot of hours beyond 3 million of atoms. Okay. So we have a technology to go beyond, but we'll have to wait for the computers. But FFTs are, but you don't see it for the HFR or small molecules, small proteins, it's quite okay. Beyond 2-3 million people, atoms, you start to have FFT issues. Communication are really bad.
All right, well, let's thank Jean-Philippe again.